Had it ever happened where someone who you trusted work with later did turn out to be a legitimate informer?
Yeah. That's what's Operation Kenova at the moment. That rat, no. He's known as a familiar face. Yeah. Kenova said he's a person of interest. He was actually involved in the execution of your brother. There's sufficient evidence to suggest that the British were involved in this. The Ministry of Defence were involved in the execution of Miguel. The conspiracy to setting him up and the agents involved. So the writ has been served on the Ministry of Defence. The problem with this, John, I'm going to tell you this for the first time. I've never spoke about this, but I'm going to tell you it now. So as it turned out, after it was over, Miguel was cleared. Got the, you know, the fanfare was over. I was working on a job in July 2016. It was a rewire, and I got a phone call. And this was to be the beginning of part two of the same story. And it was from my solicitor, Kevin Winters. And he says, could you call down to the office someday? Here's me, why? I'm busy. What are you doing? I says, I'm doing a rewire of a house in Rosetta, in South Belfast. He says, well, I don't want to say too much, but sure, why don't you call down? So I called down 3 or 4 weeks later, and there was three solicitors sitting there. And one of the solicitors, Kevin, says, what's this about? He says, we're going to ask you a few questions and see how intelligent you are, see how knowledgeable you are on the answers. I said, okay, go ahead. I hadn't a clue what he was going to say. He says, what's your view of Freddie Scabatici? I said, flip. I says, for what it's worth, and I know there's a lot of disinformation out there, a lot of cover-up, a lot of smoke and mirrors, but Freddie Scabatici is not actually a hard-working Republican from Riverdale in West Belfast, stitched up by British media. He's actually a British military officer attached to the Force Research Unit, 14th Intelligence Company, the biggest spy since the Second World War. That's who he is. And the three solicitors looked at each other and said, my God, he says, where'd you get that information? Why have you not went along with the rest? Here's me, I don't go. I've always been able to think for myself, first of all. And secondly, I spoke to Brenton Hughes. He told me the truth. Right. He says, well, Brenton Hughes is correct, Seamus. He's a British military agent. And his code name is Stakeknife. That was part two, started in July, August 2016. And that's been part two of my journey, which takes me right up to this second where I'm talking to you. And it's still a job in progress.
While you were like an active member, were you aware? I know Scabatici only joined, I think, kind of late 70s or so, but even at that time when you were still active, were you aware of someone? Were you aware of a man named Scabatici who was the nothing spot? This only came after?
No, I only heard about him in 1986. Someone said to me, what's your plans for Miguel? It was my cousin. And we were in Bangor. And he brought up this name. I just got out, went down to see him. And he says, have you looked at what happened to Miguel? Has anyone told you when you're in the prison? I says, nobody's come near me. He says, right. He says, well, see if it ever lands on your lap. Remember this name. Here's me. Go ahead. He says, Freddie Scabatici had your Miguel. Flip. Who's he? I says, is he an ice cream man? And he says, no, he's not. Apparently, he's an IRA man. And apparently, he was close to the interrogation of Miguel. And that's when I first heard that. That was March 86. I never heard of him before. Knew nothing about him.
I assume you'd have been aware, even before you were aware of Scabatici, of a team known as like the Nothing Squad.
Yeah, then. Yeah, I knew about them. Yeah. I was aware of them.
Had it ever happened where someone who you knew, trusted, worked with later did turn out to be like a legitimate informer?
Outside of that unit?
As in, like, someone that you had previously worked on some job somewhere that turned out to be a rat.
Yeah. That's what's Operation Kenova at the moment. That rat.
Come again, the Operation what?
That name has been handed to Operation Kenova. The rat.
The one that you had worked with. What's that like? Just as a. As an emotion, when you figure out that someone who you trusted and who could have put you away or had you killed or something was actually not on your side,
Completely devastating would be an understatement, John. Completely devastating doesn't really cut it. It's someone that's close to you, rubbing skin with you. It's actually an agent. Kenova has just simply said he's a person of interest in this. Known as the familiar face. That's what we call him, the familiar face.
There's a particular rat that's known as the familiar face. And his identity hasn't been made public.
No. He's known as the familiar face. Yeah. Kenova said he's a person of interest. He was actually involved in the execution of your brother. He's known as local knowledge or the familiar face.
If you don't mind me asking, you said that a lot of the information that you kind of unearthed is with your solicitor now. You mentioned meetings with your solicitor. Are you in the middle of a legal case or bringing something?
We've served a writ on the Ministry of Defence. The writ was served a few months ago. There, it was on the advice of my solicitor. There's sufficient evidence to suggest that the British were involved in this. The Ministry of Defence were involved in the execution of Michael, the conspiracy, the setting him up, and the agents involved. So the writ has been served on the Ministry of Defence.
I don't know if this is a coincidence, but there's a kind of a report or a commission coming soon. What's the name of there? Let me have a look.
It's Operation Kenova. It's led by John Boutcher. It commenced in June 2016. It had a 5-year remit. It was meant to end in June 21, and it's went on and on and on. Operation Kenova, which is to investigate an individual codenamed Stakeknife, and also the IRA's internal security unit. So that went on. That remit was June 2016 to June 21. It was given 35 million. That's now went up to 37 million. And that begs the question, oh my God, if I have unearthed this information and I haven't made one penny out of this, and that didn't need one penny, what the hell's going on with 37 million? So it begs the question of, how do you validate that? And it still hasn't really, the report was meant to come out in January 2023. I've already met John Boutcher. I've met him twice. I've met the family liaison officer. I've spoke to him, I've met him. And he said the report will be out in January 2023, and then February, and then March, and then April, and then May, and then June. Now it's September. And, you say to yourself, 37 million, 5 years, went past its sell-by date. It's now 23, and it's still going on. The money's still getting pumped into those 70 personnel from the London and the outer London area. They're still making a huge amount of money, and you're saying to yourself, nothing's being delivered. Up to now. I think John Boucher's well-intentioned, but I have to be perfectly honest. I say to myself, okay, is it national security? Probably is. I'm not saying it's not, but it's now getting security checked at Whitehall at the minute. In other words, ask my brother, am I a liar? The same people that I've served the writ on, they're now security checking him, his report before it's released. So right away, I have a jaundiced view of it all. You understand? So the people that I've served the writ on, Ministry of Defence, are now looking at that report that he's meant to release, and they're holding it back. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, they're trying to push through legacy, which is what you talked about earlier, the reconciliation bill. They're trying to push that through as quickly as possible. It's now been stalled to the 5th of September, 2023. They try to ram it through for 27th of July, before the summer recess, 25th, 27th of July. They failed to do that because it was playing ping pong politics between the House of Lords and the House of Commons. It's now put back to the 5th of September. They're trying to get it through to make it law to cover their troops and to cover all their dirty tricks. So this story, John, to call us, I always love to, always like that when I give it, when someone gives me a question, I like to give them a direct answer. This is about the British it's not really about the IRA. The IRA were duped. So, you know, this is the architects of the dirty war were the British. The architects of the dirty war were the British government and its surrogates. The IRA were duped. So, for example, Michael, the reason why we served the writ on the Ministry of Defence, and we believe it's a strong enough case, is because Michael's murder, his killing, was organised in Castlereagh. They made a decision, and we have the proof. They made the decision to release him, to hand him over to Scapatici and that internal security unit, not to protect Scapatici. He didn't need to be protected. That unit didn't need to be protected. They were invaded in by the IRA, but the IRA were carrying out their procedure. They didn't know they were in the agents, but they were, Michael was then taken down south. And it was from that point on, we know the paper trail. We know, for example, on July the 6th, Scapatici is reporting back to his handler, along with the head of internal security, who's the member, former member of the Special Boat Service. He's also reporting back. We know that. We have that detail. Both of them, both the head of the internal security unit and Scapatici, are reporting back to their respective handlers that Michael Kearney's situation is grave, that he's getting charged with breach of general army orders, July the 6th. This is 6 days before he's executed. And we also are, or we know through Scapatici's MISR, Scapatici has wrote a MISR. He didn't write it, but his handlers wrote a MISR. A MISR is a Military Intelligence Source Report, MISR. We also know that the SB50 form has been wrote on behalf of the internal security unit, the head of it. He's also contacted his handler. His form is an SB50 contact form. That's how the RUC operate their forms. The military, because Scapatici belongs to the military, he's told his handler. The handler's wrote out his MISR, his MISR. That was found in Whitehall in 2019. Scapatici is telling the handler, this is dire for Michael Kearney. He's getting executed. And it says he's put in an appeal, but it is unlikely the appeal will succeed. That's Scapatici's exact words. He's put in an appeal, but it is unlikely that it will succeed. And why? It's because of this. They're going to put him down for the short strand bombs. So Michael's going to get executed for this to cover two of their own informers. Not Scap. Scap doesn't need to be protected. It's two informers, but they're going to facilitate this. They are being told by the handlers are telling Scap and the other boyo, let that run. Because this is all started in Castlereagh. He's getting shot. So it's on a need to know basis. They're not actually telling Scap, oh, this is the reason. Just run with that. In other words, give the impression, just run with that. Get me? Run. In other words, Michael's not getting shot to cover Scap. Scap doesn't need covered. Michael's getting covered for the guy who's responsible for the bombs being found in the short strand.
This is the man who they're covering from is the person you're referring to as a familiar face, or is it someone different?
Yes, he's the one in West Belfast. The familiar face is getting protected in West Belfast, but there's also a member. They're doing a double dunder. The guy in the short strand, he's in the warehouse. He's in the warehouse. That's the reason why the SAS don't go for the kill. They're about to go into the warehouse. There's 30 volunteers about. They are going for a panzer kill. They're going for a kill. But they've been told to stand down. They can't go into the warehouse because one of their agents are in the warehouse. That's what the SAS are being told, stand down. One of our agents are in that warehouse. You're going to shoot him. So they're stood down.
Sorry. The familiar face isn't that guy. A separate one.
He's not in the warehouse.
Okay, he's separate. Okay.
It's quite complex. So they could have charged Michael, but they've decided not to. And they've decided to release him to cover two agents, one in West Belfast, one in East. So Michael's getting executed. He's getting stitched up the back. The problem with this, John, I'm going to tell you this for the first time. I've never spoke about this, but I'm going to tell you it now. Something goes technically wrong while Michael's down south.
While he's being interrogated?
Yes, something goes wrong. Skip realizes, oh my God, what has happened here? And what goes wrong is this. Michael was lifted on Wednesday, June the 20th. He's released 3 days later, Saturday, June the 23rd. He's handed over to internal security on Monday, June the 25th. He's down there for 16 days. He's court-martialed on July the 6th. He's going to be executed on July the 12th. Scapatici has told the handlers he's getting shot. It's up to, not up to Scapatici. It's up to the handlers to report back to their superiors. He can be saved, but they've decided no. Why? Because they've already put a target on his back in Castlereagh and sent him out for a reason. He's been given a role. So, to cover these two agents, Scapatici and the internal security, as they will do in the future, will facilitate these executions. Michael's the first, by the way. Michael Kearney's the first. He's not the last, he's the first. But this is the beginning of the pattern where they're going to use internal security for their own ends. If they're going to decide who goes, who lives, and who dies. The British decide, it's not the IRA. The IRA may rubber stamp it. Army Council may rubber stamp stuff, but it's based on the trust that they've had in internal security. Do you get me? So, something goes seriously wrong on July the 6th when Scapatici says to Michael, you were responsible for the short strong bombs. They're accusing him. And for the first time, Michael says, no. You drove them over, yep, which he did do. So he was involved in that, which implicates him, sets him up. So he delivered the 42 bombs to the short strong. But they say to him, well, we think you're the informer. But Michael does something. He's on the ropes. He defends himself. No, it's not me. Anyway, it's in my debriefing report. That's when the alarm bells go off. Where's that? They should have picked that up. It's a technical error on their behalf. He should have had the debriefing report with him. They were going to destroy it, but they couldn't destroy it if it wasn't with them. Scapatici says, where's that? Is that with you? No. Now there's alarm bells ringing. Where's that? That debriefing report will prove my innocence. That's a dilemma for them. We need to get that. Where is that?
The report.
He says it's in a cornflakes box in our house, 23 Glenvie Drive, in the kitchen. There's alarm bells ringing. They need to get that. That's a paper trail back to them. So they send somebody to get it. They can't find it. My brother Sean opens the door. He says they were looking at it. I searched for it and couldn't find it. They said it's in a cornflakes box. He says, I'd only come back from Germany. I didn't know what they were talking about. But apparently our Michael said it was in a cornflakes box, but I couldn't find the bloody cornflakes box. It wasn't in the kitchen. I asked my mum. Mum was sitting in the living room. She said, I don't know what you're talking about. So they went back empty-handed, but it was to be their downfall. And they went back to Michael and said they couldn't find it. But in that report on page 3, it said, we followed you over to the short strong. They told him he wasn't telling them. That would have proved his innocence.
Has that report since ever been uncovered?
What had happened, John, was the journey of the debriefing report was Michael was executed on July the 12th, 79. They were probably fingers crossed. Nobody, that doesn't show up. Maybe he was lying. Maybe Scapatici was saying, maybe he was lying. Maybe he wasn't. Maybe he was. I don't know. They never got it. They would try to get it. They couldn't find it. So about 3 years later, the kitchen floor, new tiles were going down. But the guy come up, this is 3 years later, 2 or 3 years later. So he said to Sean, my brother, Sean, for me to put those tiles down, I would need to pull that dresser out. And he says, sure, I can give you a hand. He says, that's okay. So do you want to do it now? He says, I'll pull it out. So the two of them pulled it out, and then behind the dresser was the cornflakes box with the debriefing report on it. It was in a brown envelope in the cornflakes box. So I got out in 1986. So that would have probably been 79, 80, 81, 80, probably 82. So I get out 4 years later, and we go for a walk up to Shaw's Bridge, and Sean puts his hand in his pocket and gives me this brown envelope. I says, "What's this?" And he says, "That's our mixed debriefing report. Those efforts came looking at it. I would have given them it, but I couldn't find it." But he says, "Maybe it'll, I don't know, it's probably better in your hands than mine." So I held that, and that was the main plank that got uncleared in 2003. The IRA investigation seen that. I didn't give them an original. They got a copy, but they wanted to see the original, and they confirmed that it was true. It was an original because the paper was yellowed. And that was the main plank that got him cleared. When it came to Boutcher in 2016, I'd met them in 2016. I mentioned this when I mentioned you. So he right away wanted it, but I says no. He says, "Well, could I have a copy of it?" Yeah, so he has a copy of it. Operation Kenova.
I won't keep you too much more. Thank you again. Everything you're sharing, I appreciate it very much.
When you're talking about Scabatici and you're talking about the internal security unit, it's erroneous to blame everything on him. I know he died in April, but if he was sitting there, he would say, "John, you need to listen to Seamus." I was a member of the Force Research Unit, but I can't be responsible for everything. And I wasn't a one-man band. And he's right, I had to be invited in. And for every case that I've studied, they're always invited in. They're invited in. Internal security must be invited in. Why? Because they need local knowledge. They need to know, what are we asking this guy? Who is he? Michael Kearney. Well, what are we asking him? I don't know. What do you want to ask him? They need local knowledge. They need somebody to say. The familiar face needs to say, "Well, ask him about the short-strand bombs." Scabatici then goes in and says, "Okay, what about the short-strand bombs, Mike? Or what about such and such, such and such?" He's getting this information from the guy next door. Local knowledge. So he's invited in, and he needs local knowledge. And it's not all about protecting Scabatici. Scabatici does not need to be protected. But it's working on a strategic initiative that the Brits have formulated to remove certain people. You know, for example, 1985, the branch decide to get rid of two informers to protect another one. So it's leaked to internal security, SCAP, that these two are informers. SCAP is then told, pick them up. Do you see what's happening? It's the British that are the main puppet masters here. They've duped the IRA. The IRA are not the architects of the dirty war. If you talk about the architects of this particular war, the intelligence war, it's the British and the skullduggery that they were involved in. And that's the reason why we've served a writ on the Ministry of Defence in the murder of Michael Kearney.
Do you, I guess two questions. Do you think any members of, like, any previous handlers, any members of British security, any of them will end up facing the music, number one? And number two, do you think, like, the legal action you're going through now about your brother, do you think if that was to, like, fully resolve itself in a satisfactory way, would that like close a wound, or would it provide any kind of closure?
I've been at this since 40 years, and it doesn't seem to end. But Michael Spirit is there with me. He's helping me. I know that might sound strange, but he's never too far away. His spirit, I know he's left his mortal existence, but his spirit guides me. And I would ask him to help me, and he has up to now. So his journey's not over yet. His story's not over yet. And I take my lead from him, you know. But I'll always say to him, Mick, open up a door so I can walk through it. Give me an opportunity. And he has done that up to now, which is quite incredible. And he's not finished yet. But I'm looking after his case on Earth. And I know he can't do it for himself, so he's relying on me to do it, and I will get to the bottom of it. And I have been fortunate up to now that we've got so much further than a lot of cases. But it's not over yet. But we're near closure. We're near close. There's a couple of pieces of jigsaw John's still missing, you know, and that's, but I think Boutcher could actually help us do that. Whether he's prepared to do it, I don't know. I've asked him to go the extra mile. Whether he's prepared to do that, or he's capable of doing it, I don't know. Only he can answer that. But I've told him to go the extra mile. It's not a 9-to-5 job. This is a vocation. And I don't know if John's into vocations, but if John Boucher's into vocations, then he will reach the end of this with me. If he's not, and if he's in the 9-to-5 job picking up 37 million, then he'll not get any further. He'll be another John Stevens, another John Stalker Stevens, another failed inquiry.
On a personal level, do you think it would bring you any kind of closure to, if at least if it became like publicly known what you know about your brother, was it that he wasn't actually a rat and that was mislabeling? He was a victim of of this dirty war, as you call it. You know, would it bring closure to you to make that bit public?
Yeah, would I? Yeah, that would be his legacy. You know what I mean? That you know, I'm just one of those people that, if it's not sitting right, then it's not sitting right. It should sit right. And his death has never sat right with me since this whole case, since I took on the promise with my mum. And it hasn't sat right. And it's still not sitting right until we reach the conclusion. And I've outlined the conclusion, the proposed conclusion. And if that happens, then yeah, for me personally, yeah, that would be closure. There is actually a case of closure here. I knew back in 2003, even at the mass, there was not, that it wasn't the end. And I told the IRA, this is, I'm going with the sanitized version, but there's more to this. There will be a part two. And this is part two that I'm involved in. It's not over yet. He's meant to release his report in June. It's now been put back to September, John Boutcher, and he can confirm a lot of stuff. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, you have the legacy trying to rush it through way through Parliament, where they know what their role is. They know that people like me are coming after them, and they know, oh my God, we need to stop this nutcase from chasing us. So they know that. So they're trying to bring in a legacy bill, which if it's ratified in September, after the summer recess, that will give them a certain amount of cover, because they know their role was not a UN peacekeeping force. They know their role was a colonial. They know that this was a colonial war, and they know their role in it. So they're determined to cover their dirty tricks up and what their main role was, because they don't want their legacy, the British government's legacy on the north. They would rather have this, oh, we were involved in trying to keep the two warring sides apart when they weren't. They were up to their neck in dirty tricks, skullduggery. And as I say, they would like to say, oh, it was the IRA shot, Michael. No, it wasn't. Technically, the IRA were involved, but he's had a big role in the execution of my brother. And that changes the narrative. It does change the narrative. When you look at the statistics, and if I win this case, then I'm not saying I will, but I'm saying I'll try my best. But if I do, then it throws everything into the air, because you look at the statistics and say, well, the IRA shot this, the British Army shot these, and you go, whoa, hold on here. Hold on. You know, oh, technically, oh, but the IRA shot Michael Kearney? No.
They pulled the trigger, but yeah.
You see what I'm saying? The whole narrative has changed. And Michael's not the only case. He was the first. They were involved in other cases where they were setting people up for execution. Branch mom was asked recently, former branch mom, was that policy, what yous were doing, that skullduggery? And he says, the words he used was, it wasn't policy, it was practice. By that answer, I think it seems to be they were given a free hand.
Yeah, sure. There was a certain amount of blind eye being, and as long as you, I'm sure it was the case that as long as you didn't kick up too much hassle and bring too much heat onto the British government, then do what you like to get the job done, I'd imagine. Yeah.
So there you have in the prisons, I can talk about that, where they basically let the prison officers down, screw them, use them as cannon fodder. They were carrying on what they'd done, but there was no paper trail back to them and the brutality in the blocks. And now you have here, in the intelligence war, where they're non-accountable. You know what I mean? It's they're non-accountable. Their fingerprints are not there. They're not. Their fingerprints aren't on the H blocks. Blame that on the prison officers, and their fingerprints aren't on this Michael Kearney's death. I'd blame that on the IRA. They're good at it. You know, they are good. You have to give them that. But they got their experience from Malaya in 1947, and then from Cyprus, and then Aden, and the north. So they've had a lot of experience. You know, so they've been good at it.
Very good. I'll leave you go there. Hopefully we'll speak again in the future when the application into Scapatici, your own legal efforts, plus the legacy and reconciliation. Maybe we can speak again when they've wrapped up, and maybe more has come to light.
So, as I say, it's a work in progress, John. That's where you've got me. It's not over yet. You have legacy. You have the serving of the writ, which was in May. So that's run alongside it, and then you have Boutcher's report, which everyone over here, everyone, the whole media, are waiting on with bated breath on him releasing that report. And as I say, it kept getting put back and put back and put back and put back, and that's frustrating. It's frustrating that we're waiting 7 years with nothing to show for it, but a lot of money been spent. 37 million, John. 37 million.
If I'm to make a prediction, I'd have to imagine that what will come out will be fairly minimal and it won't
soft landing.
And it won't actually implicate any British agents in a way that action would have to be taken. I'm sure it'll be the bare minimum.
I agree. Bare minimum. But that's what I'm telling you. That's the truth. But that'll not appear in an official report.
Very good. Is there any final thoughts you want to leave us with there just before we wrap up?
I got covered everything. That's the other thing. On what I was saying. That's the report of the Independent Panel of Inquiry into the circumstances of the H-Block and Armagh prison protests. So anything I was saying to you, they've verified it in an international panel. And the international panel, this came out in October 2020 about the H-Block situation. It was run by Richard Harvey, who has served on the War Crimes Tribunal at The Hague, and the former Attorney General of Canada, Warren Allman, and Richard Harvey. They were a panel. I submitted what I was saying to you about my experiences in the blocks, and there was about 90 witnesses, 90 people like me, and it said this came out on October 20, and it was an independent panel made up of those people. It just says, having considered the findings of this report on the circumstances surrounding the H-Block protest 76-81, having considered the evidence of former prisoners whose lives remain scarred by physical and psychological suffering and social disabilities, the panel unhesitatingly concludes that the inhuman conditions in which these prisoners were held were calculated to cause intense physical and mental suffering with the intention of humiliating and debasing prisoners and breaking their physical and moral resistance. Further, from the contextual evidence and expert opinions sought by the international panel regarding specific types of ill treatment and its impact, its conclusion is that many protesting prisoners in the H-Blocks and HMP Armagh were subjected to torture. The state, the British state, should reject the proposition that the suffering of former prisoners was self-imposed or self-inflicted. It was not. It was the consequence of a purposeful policy implemented by the UK government, whose institutions were fully aware that their policies and practices violated international human rights law and standards and breached common law and statute. The international panel concludes, based on all the evidence received, that the ultimate legal and moral responsibility for this torture, inhuman and degrading treatment over a 5-year period rests on the British Prime Minister and senior cabinet ministers who knew and approved of that treatment. That's conclusive, John. In other words, they would say to you, if they were listening, you know, they would say, the British government would say, don't listen to him. That was all self-inflicted. That's all IRA propaganda. But that's an international panel from the former Attorney General of Canada, Warren Allman, Richard Harvey, International War Crimes Tribunal, that it's the British were in the dock and they were responsible for the torture in the H-Blocks. You know what I mean? And I, as I say, 90 of us give our testimonies, and that's been upheld by this panel. And the only thing now is Scabatici and my brother, the servant of the writ. That's another battle for another day, and that's a work in progress. I would like to reach a conclusion, John. I'd like to reach a stage where we win the writ, we win the court action. I don't know if we will or not. I'll do my best. And also that John Boutcher doesn't run away and does what he's meant to do and tells the truth about Scabatici and his role and that role of a British military officer working for the British government.
Very good. Just one last small thing. You said if you win the action that you're taking, what does a win actually consist of? Will it be like a handler being convicted of misconduct? No.
Well, basically, John, what it would mean at this stage would be the writ served would be a case where we're waiting on Boutcher, and if Boutcher, you know, in the report simply says Michael's life could have been saved, and it was the security forces were responsible, they could have saved him, then that's them implicated. Therefore, that would be a win. We bring that to court, and then out of that, the British government would have to admit liability. That's what that means, liability. It doesn't mean criminal. It doesn't mean going to prison. I think we're beyond that, John. You know what I'm saying? If you're heading down the road of legacy and all that, the British government are not interested in locking people up anymore. They want to draw a line under it. That's what we're heading towards. But that action there would probably be one of the last before that steel door comes down. And it might fail. It might fail because the British could be just simply say, no, it's all over. We threw a line under that. That's it over. We're handing this over now to Declan Morgan, who commences in May 2024, a truth commission. Do you get me? That's what they're talking about now. So there's a lot going on, John, a lot of complexities.